beautiful life.
สวัสดีครับ Good afternoon and welcome to A Beautiful Life on englishonline.rmutp.ac.th. My name is อาจารย์เกษม เกษมพุทธเรืองศรี Your host for the program. A Beautiful Life is a program broadcasted every Monday from 1 p.m. to 1:30 p.m. Articles and information about life lessons or good phrases from the books or websites will be presented in this program together with the latest news from ราชมงคล University of Technology พระนครฟรีอยู่ที่นี่ Today we start with the article from China News Asia. They say eat a rock a day, put glue on your pizza. How Google's AI is losing touch with reality. Google search feature AI overview tool has been giving user weird answers to their questions. If this is really the future of search, then we are in for a bumpy ride, says this professor from University of New South Wales. Toby Welch, reported from Sydney. Google has rolled out its latest experimental search feature on Chrome, Firefox, and the Google App browser to hundreds of millions of users. AI overviews save you clicking on links by using generative AI, the same technology that powers rival product ChatGPT, to provide summaries of the search result, ask how to keep bananas fresh for longer, and it uses AI to generate a useful summary of tips, such as storing them in a cool, dark place and away from other fruits like apples. But ask it a left-field question and the result can be disastrous or even dangerous. Google is currently scrambling to fix these problems one by one, but it is a PR disaster for the search giant and a challenging game of whack-a-mole. AI overviews helpfully tell you that whack-a-mole is a classic arcade game where players use a melee to hit moles that pop up at random for points. The game was invented in Japan in 1975 by the amusement manufacturer Toko and was originally called Mogura Taiji or Mogura Tataki. But AI overviews also tell you that astronauts have met cats on the moon, played with them, and provided care. More worryingly, it also recommends you should eat at least one small rock per day, as rocks are a vital source of minerals and vitamins, and suggests putting glues in pizza topping. Why is this happening? One fundamental problem is that generative AI tools don't know what is true, just what is popular. For example, there are not a lot of articles on the web about eating rocks, as it is so self-evidently a bad idea. There is, however, a well-read satirical article from The Onion about eating rocks, and so Google's AI bested its summary on what was popular, not what was true. Another problem is that generative AI tools don't have our values. They are trained on the large chunk of the web. And while sophisticated techniques that go by exotic names such as reinforcement learning from human feedback or RLHF are used to eliminate the words, it is unsurprisingly, they reflect some of the bias, conspiracy theories, and words to be found on the web. Indeed, the writer of this article said he is always amazed how polite and well-behaved AI chatbots are, given what they are trained on. Is the future of search? If this is really the future of search, then we are in for a bumpy ride. Google is, of course, playing catch up with OpenAI and Microsoft. The financial incentives to lead the AI race are immense. Google is, therefore, being less prudent than in the past in pushing the technology out into users' hands. In 2023, Google Chief Executive Sundar Pichai said, We have been cautious. There are areas where we have chosen not to be the first to put a product out. We have set up good structures around responsible AI. You will continue to see us take our time. That no longer appears to be so true. As Google responds to criticisms that it has become a large and lethargic competitor, a risky move. It's a risky strategy for Google. It risks losing the trust and the public has in Google being the place to find correct answer to questions. But Google also risks undermining its own billion-dollar business model if we no longer click on links. Just read their summary. How does Google continue to make money? The risks are not restricted to Google. The writer of this article, he said he feared such use of AI might be harmful for society more broadly. Truth is already a somewhat contested and fungible idea. AI untruth are likely to make this worse. In a decade's time, we may look back at 2024 as the golden age of the web, when most of it was quality human-generated content before the bots took over and filled the web with synthetic and increasingly low-quality AI-generated content. Has AI started breathing its own exhausted? The second generation of large language models are likely and unintentionally being trended on some of the output of the first generation, and lots of AI startups are touting the benefits of training on synthetic AI-generated data, but training on the exact frames of correct AI model risks, amplifying even small bias and errors. Just a breathing and in exact frames is bad for human, it is bad for AI. These concerns fit into a much bigger picture. Globally, more than $400 million is being invested in AI every day, and governments are only now just waking up to the idea we might need guardrails and regulations to ensure AI is used responsibly, given this torrent of investment. Pharmaceutical companies are not allowed to release drugs that are harmful, nor are car companies. But so far, tech companies have largely been allowed to do what they like. Toby Walsh is a retired fellow and senior professor of artificial intelligence at the University of New South Wales in Sydney, Australia. This commentary first appeared on The Conversation, so you can read more about this from China News Asia. Next, why is UK Prime Minister Rishi Sunak proposing mandatory national service? UK Prime Minister Rishi Sunak's plan to require all school leavers to fulfill a year of military or civic service is the best idea to come out of the UK election so far, say Bloomberg opinion Adrian Woodridge. Adrian Woodridge reported from London. The philosopher author Schopenhauer said all truth passes through three stages. First, it is ridiculed. Second, it is violently opposed. Third, it is accepted as being self-evident. So the writer of this article said he very much hoped this is the fate of Rishi Sunak's idea of compulsory national service of school leavers. Sunak's first big announcement of the election campaign was that a re-elected conservative government will oblige all 18-year-olds to take part in a form of national service. This will come in two forms. A minority will serve full time in the military for a year, while the majority will be expected to do voluntary work for 1 week and every month for non-military organizations such as the fire service, the police, and NHS or charities. Basically, bunkers enter the predictable ridicule. Keir Smart, Starmer, Labour's leader, denounced that the idea as a teenage Dad's army. The Twitter mob lambasted the Tory for pandering to the colonial blimp, engaging in geriatric nostalgia, scapegoating the young, engaging in social engineering, playing politics with national defense, and launching a £2.5 billion or about $3.2 billion initiative without working out the details. There is a striking imbalance, for example, between serving the military full-time for a year and volunteering for just 1 week and a month. And there is no clarity about what sanctions people will face if they don't turn up, Home Secretary James cleverly said. No one will go to jail for refusing to participate, or how national service will affect the now scattered British tradition of the gap year. Fleet Street went to town on the fact that the Veterans Minister Johnny Mercer, himself a former soldier, dismissed the idea just 4 days before Sunak's announcement on the grounds that being in the military is very different now. There are signs that ridicule will harden into sustained opposition in the unlikely event that the Tory win the coming election. Senior military figures vented their long-standing hostility to conscription. Admiral Alan West, a former First Sea Lord, proclaimed that the idea is basically bonkers. Richard Dennett, a former chief of the general staff, went with electoral opportunism. And there are certainly legitimate objections to the conservatives' big idea from lack of detail about what it will cost and how it will be paid for. To failure to prepare the public for their new thinking, the conservatives foolishly reinforced the impression that they are pandering to older voters by then announcing they are upgrading the triple lock on pensions to be to a quadruple lock, but none of this criticism is this positive. The fact that the Tory are embracing a new policy after 14 years in power is a sign they are continuing to think. National service as a cold shower. The writer of this article said he will have plenty to say about Sunak's failure as a campaigner in the next day or so. But his idea for national conscription is an exception to what has otherwise been a maze. It needs to be subjected to serious debate rather than asinine ridicule. He has recognized that we live in a very different world from the one we inhabited after the fall of the Soviet Union. Today, Russian troops are rampaging through Ukraine. Vladimir Putin and Xi Jinping are pledged eternal friendship. Iran's proxies are stirring up trouble across the Middle East and British allies in the Nordic country. France and the Baltic have either reintroduced some form of national service or are thinking of doing so. The strongest argument in favor of national service is that it will engineer a change in public attitude towards military risks. The public has not yet woken up to the full extent of the danger from the autocratic powers. People still regard the war in Ukraine as a humanitarian catastrophe rather than a strategic risk, and China saber rattling as noise of the stage. National service would act as a cold shower for people who have been wallowing in the warm bath of the peace divided long since it has run out. We can no longer afford to contract out welfare to professional cadre of soldiers while leaving the population at large to go about their business in blissful ignorance. Even the restricted military service that Sunak envisages will help to create a reservoir of skill in the population that can be called on in future conflicts. In Switzerland and Norway, the 18 years old who serve become a trained reserve that can be used to expand their professional army when needed. The conservatives are frustratingly vague about the relationship between volunteering and military service, but even people who don't go down the army route could be given instruction in the dangers of information war and cyber threats. Not only military benefits, national service might also help Britain address three other pressing problems. One is the mental and physical health crisis among the young. Fully one in eight, 16 to 24 years old, claim to be suffering from long-term health problems, and the growth of health problems in this group is worse than any other group within the working age population. This is largely driven by mental health issues, often associated with loneliness, alienation, and screen addiction. Through rising level of obesity among the young also play a part. Hardcore military service would obviously be good for physical fitness, but even volunteering would help to reconnect young people to the wider society. Contrary to Labour's insistence that national service represents a conspiracy of or against the young, a survey for the think tank Onward, laying out the case for national service, found that 2/3 or 66% of those ages 18 to 34 wanted to help out locally. The second problem is social fragmentation. Britain is increasingly a class-bound society in which privileged young Britons only met their less privileged contemporaries when they receive their Amazon parcel or decaf lattes. The higher education system only reinforces such social division. National service would thwart people from different backgrounds to engage in a common experience directed at a shared aim, defending the country from anti-democratic enemies. The third is opportunity. Britain's last great attempt to improve upward mobility by expanding higher education was only a partial success in part because middle-class girls did so much better than working-class boys. Military service could create a new avenue of upward mobility that might appear to people who demonstrate practical skills and team leadership more than academic virtues. Here, Sweden's example is both instructive and encouraging. Only people who can pass rigorous mental and physical tests are allowed to choose the military rather than the civic option in Sweden's compulsory national service. They are then trained in welfare and leadership for 15 months and enrolled in Sweden's reserve for another 10 years. Sweden's annual armed service recruitment rate now tops America's, and the products of the enlistment system are routinely showered with job offers from employers. Election campaigns being what they are, they can expect nothing but ridicule from the Labour Party on Sunak's grand idea, but for how much longer? David Lammy, Starmer's shadow foreign secretary and one of the party's biggest beats, has vigorously advocated a form of compulsory national service, though of an exclusively civil variety, even if Sunak is not around in to implement his big idea. The writer of this article said he has no doubt that it will eventually become self-evident. So you can read more about this from China News Asia. And we'll be right back after a short break.
Beautiful life.
You are listening to A Beautiful Life on EnglishOnline.rmutp.ac.th. We are back to the news from Ratchamongkol University of Technology, Phanakorn. Ratchamongkol University of Technology, Phanakorn strengthened moral knowledge, ethics, and code of conduct. Dr. Natwarapon Ratsiri Wacharabun, president of Ratchamongkol University of Technology, Phanakorn, shared the opening of the knowledge project about morality, ethics, and code of conduct at a Marine Room, 3rd floor, SD Avenue Hotel, Bangkok, on April 25th, 2023, attended by 150 university personnel, with the objective of increasing knowledge of morality, correct ethics and moral in the work of personnel, create efficiency and effectiveness in their work, to prevent disciplinary offense, civil law, and strengthen morality, ethics, and code of conduct for personnel, including creating knowledge and understanding about the application of moral principles. Ethics and code of conducts, or ethics and code of ethics, are used in work performance, be in good moral discipline, and be a good and correct role model for society. This event was honored by Kun Niwatchai Kasem Mongkon, Secretary General of the Committee, Office of the National Anti-Corruption Commission, or NACC, gave a lecture on strengthening the attitude of being responsible for duty, honesty, and integrity in work. Assistant Professor Dr. Kaside Suthiwanit, Vice President for University Council Affairs, gave a lecture on moral enhancement, ethics for government officials, and Kun Orathai Homkao, legal expert, gave a lecture on knowledge about the regulations of Ratchamongkol University of Technology, Phanakorn, concerning the Code of Ethics. And the time is up for today, A Beautiful Life. Please join us on every Monday here on EnglishOnline.rmutp.ac.th. Your host has been Ajahn Kasem, Kasem Puttaryongsi. You are welcome to subscribe to our channel on EnglishOnline.rmutp.ac.th. Thank you very much for joining our program today, and see you again next Monday. Sawasdee krab.
Beautiful Life will be back again next Monday.